The next term we want to discuss is laya, which people often translate as rhythm. So tell us, what is laya and why it's not rhythm?
Here we will go backwards. Okay. First we will see what rhythm is.
Okay.
So again, going by Harvard Dictionary of Music, that's where I've taken most of the definitions from. The word rhythm appears on two semantic levels. In the widest sense, it is set beside the terms melody and harmony. And in a very general sense, rhythm covers all aspects of musical movement as ordered in time, as opposed to aspects of musical sound conceived as pitch and timbre. In the narrower and more specific sense, rhythm shares a lexical field with meter and tempo. Rhythm in that specific sense denotes a patterned configuration of attacks that may or may not be constrained overall by a meter or associated with a particular tempo. This is the definition. And another book says, rhythm can be defined as a particular arrangement of note lengths in a piece of music, sometimes matching the beat, sometimes not. So from this, it is very clear that rhythm is very gross. So it can be associated with a meter, it need not be associated with a meter, it may have a tempo, it may not have a tempo. So it is just simply keeping to a beat, and for which there need not be any logical explanation. And in the context of a musical notation, as the second definition says, how long a musical note has to be sung or played is indicated by the rhythm. Maybe the rhythm can, you can say it is an equivalent to the matra in our tradition. We say matra, one matra, two matras, so that's the unit of time. So how long a particular note has to be stretched is rhythm. Which for which there need not be any logic, there need not be any system, there need not be any overall tempo, meter, nothing. It is just that. So it is very basic or gross. Next we will see what is tala. In our system there is something called as tala. Raga and tala go hand in hand. Tala is rhythm which is well defined and represented in the form of cycles called avartas, comprising specific number of beats or aksharas. Tala is also rhythm, but it is well defined rhythm, meaning it is represented by cycles of specific number of beats. Now for example, the most basic tala in Carnatic music is the Adi Tala, which is a cycle of 8 beats. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 is Adi Tala. This is rhythm, basically rhythm, but it is represented in the form of cycles of specific number of beats. So the cycle keeps repeating. So in every cycle I will have only 8 beats. It's not that in one cycle I'll have 7, in another cycle I'll have 9. No. Number of beats in a cycle of Adi Tala, in one cycle of Adi Tala, is fixed at 8. And other tala, if I take an example of Rupaka Tala, it is a 3 beat cycle. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. So even if I put the same tala, if I put these cycles 100 times, it is going to be 3 only. So it is rhythm which is well defined and represented in the form of cycles, specific number of aksharas. And here again, there is that philosophical dimension, which in Indian music never goes away from that. Takara shankara prokto lakara shakti uchate, shiva shakti samayogat tala ityabhidhiyate. So just like how nada is combination of na and da, this is a combination, tala is a combination of ta and la. So takara stands for Shiva, lakara stands for shakti. So Shiva shakti coming together is represented as tala. And unlike Western music, the rhythmic structures there are very simple, very basic. And especially in Carnatic music, even more than Hindustani music, in Carnatic music, the complexity and the variety of talas that we have is something mind-blowing. It doesn't have a parallel. There is no comparison to the South Indian tala system, anywhere in the world. You know, so many varieties, so much of complexity, so many possibilities, so much of intricate nuances that you can bring out of it, so much of an intellectual exercise that involves, and so much of your musicianship you can bring out of the rhythmic aspect, the tala aspect. Now there is the third term, which is laya. Laya is going by the root of the word, it is derived from li shleshane dhatu, which means to merge with or be absorbed in. So laya is a highly subtle concept.
And all, I think just there's nothing even similar to that in the Western.
There's nothing even similar to that. No, nothing similar to that.
I mean, taal people often equate with rhythm, which you've shown the difference.
Yes.
But laya, I think it would be kind of strange to even think of something.
Think of something, yes. Yes. And laya, you know, it's just like raga. How I said raga is very abstract and intangible. Laya is also abstract. It is like a formless form. And laya can, exist without taala or rhythm. But taala or rhythm cannot exist without laya. So when you are referring to rhythm in the Western sense, or you are referring to taala in the Indian sense, both of those need the basis of laya. But laya as such is independent. It does not need taala. It does not need rhythm. That's the reason even a musical form like raga alapana, you know, we say alap. Alap is unbound. It is anibaddha.
Right.
It doesn't have a taala. It doesn't have a rhythmic accompaniment. You don't have a mridangam or tabla playing with you when you are doing the alap. It is freestyle exploration of the raga. So even in raga alapana, there is a laya, embedded laya. If I have to demonstrate, there is a raga called Athana in Carnatic music. Tama parisa sanirisa nisara is a standard phrase of that raga. Ma parisa, it comes in a particular, you know, you can call it a tempo or a measure. Sanirisa nisara, that has to come faster. I cannot alter the speeds here. I cannot do ma barisa. I cannot do that. That will be disturbing the laya of Athana raga. So every raga has its inherent laya, and even without the taala being employed, you have to understand the laya of the raga in order to bring out the raga in its true form.
How does it relate with mood?
Yeah, mood, this goes with hand in hand with melody. That's the speciality again. You know, going by the Western definition, both melody and rhythm, when they define, they say melody is opposed to rhythm. When they define rhythm, they say rhythm is opposed to melody. But here, the raga aspect, the melodic aspect and the laya aspect go hand in hand, and that the variation of those beats, the subtle nuances and those variations create distinct moods in the minds of a listener. And laya is represented in different ways. You know, for example, if I look at it just from the point of view of the, the percussion, the laya aspect, if I say in Adi Taala, if I take the example of Adi Taala, I will say, ta din din na, ta din din na, ta din din na, ta din din na. So here, the laya of the taala that I'm putting and the laya of the syllable or the bowl or what we call a shull, that I'm reciting is syncing. It's going hand in hand. So both the layas are matching. But there is a possibility, ta din din na, ta din din na, ta din din na, ta din din na, I can say that. So what I'm doing, I'm slightly altering the laya of my the syllables that I'm reciting. The laya of the taala is constant. So there is a laya within the laya. So mapadasadapamari that I'm singing, I'm squeezing it within two beats. So the laya of the taala is independent, and there is a laya within the laya. The laya of what I'm singing. So these kind of subtle nuances, intricacies, is possible when you play with the laya. So there is a laya in your rendition. So there is a particular way it goes, the movement. So this dimension is altogether
a whole new dimension missing.
It is not there in the Western perspective at all. And the danger is that, if you say laya is equal to rhythm, rhythm is very gross, laya is highly subtle. And as I said, in Indian music, the musical aspect and the rhythmic aspect go hand in hand. They are seen as an integrated whole. They cannot be separated from each other. Their melody is opposed to rhythm. So there is no question of this being opposed here. It is all
together.
Integrated. But here I am not saying, I am not demeaning Western music, or saying that it's no good. It has its own beauty. I'm in fact a great admirer of Western classical music myself. All I'm saying is that their approach and their basic principles are quite different, and they cannot be compared to our music. So the problem is with using a Western lens to understand Indian music. That's all. Western music, as it is a beautiful system. Indian music is unique. You understand Indian music the way it has to be understood, and I will appreciate and understand your music the way it is.